welcome to Diecast Restos. I'm Jason, and this week I'll be customising this Lesney Matchbox Superfast Ford Cortina. But fear not, with this custom I'm attempting to change my ways. I've often been criticised for overusing Citadel Gloss to enhance the casting lines. Today I will forgo this and see where we end up. Once more, my thanks to Patreon supporter Tony for sending me this Cortina. Hopefully, I will do justice to him, the Cortina custom, and all of those who have commented about my Nolan Oil obsession. Here's how the metallic light brown models looked when new, with this being a real Mark IV Cortina that the casting is based on. It was the second Cortina in the Matchbox lineup, following on from the 25D model that spanned 1968 to 1972. I'll show the 25D alongside the 55G at the video outro. This Cortina was first released in 1979 in metallic lime green. These ran into 1980 with either a red or rarer cream interior. The colour changed to metallic red for 1981 with a cream interior. The 1982 light metallic brown cars had white interiors. It was replaced in the 1-75 mainline in 1983 by the Ford Sierra XR4i or the Racing Porsche 935 for the US market. The Cortina did appear in the 2-pack series of 1984, painted red with an opaque white window. There were some which had regular transparent windows but with a tan interior. Both of these 2-pack cars had their opening doors cast shut. The Mark IV Cortina that the casting is based on was, as the name suggests, the fourth iteration of the Ford Cortina. The Cortina was conceived by Ford of Britain in 1962 as a family car that could be sold in large numbers. Unlike the German Ford Taunus counterpart, which had front-wheel drive, the British designers opted to use a rear-wheel drive layout on the Cortina. At launch, it carried the name Console Cortina, carrying over the name of the model it replaced. However, from 1964, after a minor facelift, the console name was dropped. It was available as a 2- or 4-door saloon or 5-door estate from 1963, with trim levels of Standard, Deluxe, Super and GT. The famed Lotus Cortina Mark I of 1963-1966 was a development on the platform using Ford-supplied 2-door body shells. The Mark II, which the 25D model was based on, launched in 1966. It had some styling elements in common with the US Ford Falcon 3rd Gen. It was shorter and wider, allowing for greater interior space. By 1967, the Cortina was Britain's most popular car, the goal that was originally set in 1962 at the car's launch. Body styles on the Mark II were the same as before, as were trim levels but for the addition of the 1600E. Again, the Lotus Cortina continued on, using Mark II body shells until the end of production in 1970. By now, Ford Cortina Lotus, as Ford referred to them, were all built in-house. Following the merger of Ford of Britain and Ford of Germany to create Ford of Europe, a third generation Cortina was in development in the late 60s. The Mark III was given an internal code of TC1, named for the convergence of the Taunus and Cortina for the first time. It sported the Coke bottle design popular at the time. This model Cortina also replaced the larger and more expensive Ford Corsair. The trim levels for the Mark III were base, L for luxury, XL for extra luxury, GT for grand touring, and GXL for grand extra luxury. XLE was used in Australia and New Zealand. In 1973, the 2000E trim level replaced the GXL. Then in 1976, the Mark IV Ford Cortina, sporting a very conservative, boxy body, replaced the Mark III. Little change between the two generations mechanically, with the bulk of modifications cosmetic. It retained a very subtle Coke bottle body style, but it did have enlarged glass for a brighter cabin. The Mark IV saw the first gear top-of-the-range model introduced, sporting a 2.3-litre Cologne V6 from 1977. This replaced the 2-litre Pinto engine and the 2000E badging. The power unit was also available in GL and S for sport trim levels. A 1.6 option was later added for gear trim. Again, the base and L trims carried over to this generation. In fact, if you look carefully at the back of this casting, you can read the left-hand side tiny Cortina lettering with 1.6L beneath it. This is by far and away my favourite detail of this casting. Trim levels in the UK were a badge of honour through the 60s to the 90s in particular. I really appreciate the effort put in to narrow down the extent of luxury this particular car would have had if it were real. Again, the body styles of a 2 or 4 door saloon or a 5 door estate continued. A 1.3 litre 4 cylinder engine was available on base or L Cortinas. Ross style wheels were standard on all GL, S and Ghia models, with alloy wheels an extra cost option. The Mark IV was a particularly popular car for use on the banger racing scene. This was because of their strength, rigidity and availability. However, these are now quite rare, particularly the 2 and 2.3-litre S models. Ford Australia built its own Cortina, known as the TE, equipped with either a 2-litre Pinto engine or a Falcon 3.3 or 4.1-litre straight six. The interior differed to the European car, sharing many components with the Falcon. They were also built in South Africa. The final Cortina Mark V launched in 1979. Visually very similar to its predecessor, the Mark V was essentially a facelift and styling upgrade in order to bring the Cortina in line with Ford's Fiesta, Capri and Escort design language. Improvements were made to the engines, but the range of offerings remained much the same. Body styles yet again remained the same, with base, L, GL and Ghia trim levels. The S package offered sportier optional extras rather than being seated as a trim level itself. However, an S badge was added for the final model year in 1982. That year, the Cortina remained the second best-selling car in Britain. It was discontinued in order to make way for the all-new Ford Sierra. But, owing to its popularity, the Cortina continued to sell well beyond this point up to 1987. Anyway, let's turn our attention to this casting. As with many Matchbox models of this era, the Cortina bears a number plate reading RSH88T. I always love this bit. So, for those who don't know, you can tell the age of a British car by looking at its registration. It also tells you where it was first registered. While this is naturally a false plate that never existed in reality, Lesney took their plates seriously and always gave their models realistic ones. They indicate the current age and usually a London-based registration. This would be because Lesney's factory was based in East London. So the T suffix indicates a registration date of between the 1st of August 1978 and the 31st of July 1979. Remembering that this model was released in 1979, that is spot on. The S and H of RSH interestingly do not represent a London-based registration. Instead, between 1974 and 1980, this represented Selkirk in the Scottish Borders. It's a bit of an anomaly to so many other castings. There must be a semi-interesting story behind it, but I can't find anything to suggest a reason, so it remains a mystery. A very Anoraki mystery at that. As for the R and 88, those would be more randomly assigned letters and digits. So, my detailing today will eliminate much of the use of Citadel Gloss Nuln Oil. By my own admission, I've definitely overdone it in the past. However, that won't stop me using it on the light clusters, as that absolutely improves the look of them in my mind. These headlamps would be plain silver rectangles if it wasn't for the depth Citadel brings to them. And as today's custom is a bit of a change to my ways, I thought I'd best banish the demons of my Majorette 4L build and tackle some masking. In that custom, I made a real hash of giving the body a tri-level paint job. I've been a bit anxious about doing another since then, so why not try it on this build? The effect I'm going for is a vinyl roof, often seen on Cortinas of this age. I think my past errors were not using Tamiya's masking tape, which I find to be tremendously effective in creating a good seal. I'll race through the unravelling now. It really only affected each of the pillars A to C on both sides, so there were few points of contact to mask off. Still, I needed a bit of a confidence boost with it. But as I took off the all-important pieces of tape, it was looking good. Nice, clean, crisp lines of semi-gloss black against champagne gold. I painted the 25D champagne gold way back in 2019, intending for this to be a match to the brown of the original casting. How wrong I was. If you look at this casting next to the 25D at the video outro, you'll see the two shades look very different indeed. The older casting looks sort of silvery by comparison. I'm not sure what has gone on there, or if it's just an illusion caused by the vinyl style roof. Speaking of, I'm very proud of this result. That confidence has returned. Now it is time to detail the body with plenty of black paint from my 0.7mm Artistro pen. The door guards and door handles are all treated. On the back, I lay down a base coat of chrome for the light clusters. These square blocks slightly wrap around the sides. On top of that, I highlight the Ford oval to the right of the number plate and the Cortina 1.6L badge to the left. Seeing as this car is a post-January 1973 model, it would have had white front plates and yellow rear plates, each with black lettering. However, this doesn't always stop people trying to use the older black plates with silver lettering on models newer than 1973. On the front, I used my Artistro black pen to run over the raised number plates, but on the back, I thought I'd try my Sharpie, as the paint pens tend to pool a bit on more intricate areas. Here's that Citadel again, making a very brief return. I did run over the Cortina 1.6L badge as well, just to help that show up a little better. I just couldn't help myself. So, with the base, body and doors all clear coated, we are approaching reassembly time. I first reinsert the doors, which are held in place by a metal spring. It is really coming together now, and the doors work perfectly as they should. I'll be needing to glue in the axles of my Cortina style wheels, as I had to extract the original dot dashes with a cutting bit. With those secure, I give the axle ends a dab of black to represent caps. So here are all of the parts that make up the model Cortina. In first is my UV treated windscreen that looks miles better. The plain black vinyl style interior follows, complete with tow hook. And the base seals it all together, bringing that grille in sync with the body for the first time since its makeover. So here's how the 55G Ford Cortina looked that Tony sent me. It was a pretty tired example, sporting a very yellow windscreen, a missing A-pillar with the opposite side cracked, and no evidence of the black tampos it should have. This is a prime example of a matchbox model that can be completely transformed with a bit of detailing, as it was so well cast. How do you think I did leaving all that excessive Citadel behind? I've let the casting lines do the talking this time, and I think it looks great. Tell me in the comments if this for you is an improvement, or whether I should have run across the bonnet and rear doors with some gloss. There's little evidence of that right A-pillar repair, probably slightly masked by the vinyl roof. This rear end is my favourite part. I love that Lesney included the 1.6L badging. I'll leave a link to the wheel source in the description. I think these are a great fit for a Cortina of this age. And that windscreen I've treated with hydrogen peroxide and UV to remove all that horrible yellowing. So that is that from me. Like I say, leave a comment with your thoughts on the Citadel, and please leave a like if you enjoyed this custom. My thanks to Tony again for sending in this donor model. This video wouldn't have been possible without your contribution. So thanks for watching, and I'll see you again for the next one. Bye for now.